Can everyone hear me back there? How's the sound quality for you? Perfect? Good evening, everyone. Why don't we come closer? I don't bite. No?
But I do.
Margaret said she does. Hi, I'm Sean Frederick-Borg. I'm the director of the Creative Writing Program. It's so good to see so many of you here. I wanted to talk a little bit about creative sustenance and what it's all about. About 20 years ago, a graduate student by the name of Jenny Spinner, I don't know if you remember her. She started this event called Creative Sustenance, which is a benefit reading for the Covenant Soup Kitchen in Willimantic, Connecticut. We have someone here from the board of directors. His name is Ray Aramini, who's in the back. He's going to talk a little bit about what some of the initiatives are at Covenant Soup Kitchen. But I always begin with this caveat. When I was a graduate student here, there was a period of about 2 to 3 days where I was technically homeless, okay, because my lease had ended and then my new lease wasn't going to begin, so I was living out of my car and I didn't know where to go to get a meal. And I went to the Covenant Soup Kitchen and they never asked any questions, they never turned me away. So, great organization. And Ryan Amato, would you stand up, please? This is my wonderful undergraduate intern for creative writing, Ryan Amato. He took it upon himself to raise $253 for the Covenant Soup Kitchen. Thank you very much. Ryan is also going to introduce Margaret tonight. So Ray, would you please come up and tell us a little bit about some of the initiatives that you do at the Covenant Soup Kitchen, and then we'll begin with our reading. If anyone would like to donate anything to the Covenant Soup Kitchen, I am taking donations, and I will give it to Ray at the end of the night.
Thank you for having me. When I first started coming here, Sean introduced me once as Soup Kitchen Ray, and I always took that as certainly is on my resume. I'm never going to beat Sean's story. I'm never, ever, 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 ever going to beat Sean's story. It's what we do every day. Years ago, I was involved in this bicycle ride that was from California to Willimantic, and it was across the country in 30 days. It was spectacular. And I was very, very busy trying to impress everybody with percentages and stats and mileage and miles per hour and how much my egg we could feed with this much beef with it, and just all the stuff. This kid Matt was near me. He was 11 at the time. And he said, Ray, I have an idea. And I said, Matt, not now. He said, I got to get through this shit. You know, I have a lot to do. And I was banging out percentages and pie charts and graphs and PowerPoint and all this stuff. And he said, I have an idea. And he said, Matt, not now. And so after a while, I caught myself. I said, what is so important that is going to help with this? He said, how about this? How about feeding hungry people is a very important thing. And there it is. I mean, we can sugarcoat it, we can change it, and we can try to bury it in stats and be a really glitzy government agency. But the bottom line is that feeding the totality of a person, there is nothing more. And we're able to do that just down the hill with donations the likes of Ryan's and yours. And that's the backbone, that's the bones. I mean, we can cover it with fat and cool skin and a great outfit, but that's what it is. And it's not pretty work, but it's very, very needed work. I told this story to Sean. At Christmas, I dress as Santa, and it's almost as uncomfortable as being up here, where I'm standing in Dunkin' Donuts line with a jug at stupid o'clock in the morning trying to collect money. I coach rugby at Eastern Connecticut State University, and some of my players were very tall, dysfunctional elves, and they were with me, and they weren't drunk yet, but they were there, and they had just left, and it was the end of the day, and the sun was going down, and I heard a voice behind me saying, Santa, and I turned around, and it was a mother son had a dollar bill that was so tightly folded, it could have cut me. It was perfect. And she said, Josh, honey, go put it in a jug. That's to help people who use the soup kitchen like we used to. And it very well. Here's somebody clearly is still within humble means and has made it a point to be with her son, to show her son the importance of giving back. That's what the soup kitchen does. We can talk about the 450,000 meals a year that we put out. We can talk about the 9-month renovation of epoxy floors, FRP walls, the LED lighting, and everything like that. But that doesn't mean shit. It's how we serve the meal. Because unless it's love, then the food, then it's for naught. It doesn't, food can only sustain you for so long, but it's the care in which that food is served that will make the difference. Being a beneficiary here tonight helps us to be able to do that. And I'm honored and I'm humbled to be here. And I can't thank you enough, and I can't thank you enough, right? Thank you as well. I don't usually ask questions, but they don't have any questions. That makes it a lot easier. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Ray. Really great story. Thank you so much for being here. It means a lot. And now, to the main event. Thank you guys all so much for coming out tonight. It was very, very cold. I understand. So thanks so much for coming. All right. We are not welcoming Margaret Gibson to UConn tonight, but welcoming her back. After 13 years as poet in residence at UConn, from 1993 to 2006, Gibson went inward, writing prodigiously and caring for her husband who was living with Alzheimer's. She also went out into the world at large, publishing 3 books of poetry and 1 prose memoir, and is now currently giving back to the poetry world in the immensely generous gesture of serving as the Connecticut State Poet Laureate. Her work seems to have always been this mix of inward and outward. In an early poem, Burning the Root, from her Lamont Award-winning book, Long Walks in the Early Afternoon, she writes intimately of a couple making love by a fireside. But the romantic image of their bodies curled securely together on the rug turns into a curl of smoke, not unlike the smoke of a cigarette held to a bound woman's nipple. In a more recent poem, she takes on Elizabeth Bishop's famous Villanelle, One Art, which has the refrain, "The art of losing isn't hard to master." Her poem on losing begins, "I take the daily reinvention of loss as my teacher." And in doing so, Margaret Gibson positions herself as both master and pupil. She has the courage, the gall, to take on Elizabeth Bishop. And yet she has, in this poem, and really in all of her writing, a humility that is vast, but never pious. Instead, it is in turns gentle, funny, and very serious. At the end of the poem, she is all 3 of those things, looking at her author photo as if it is photo of a stranger, saying, "You know her, Margaret Gibson, the poet," and holding on to herself for dear life. When we think of Gibson's work and the way her poems listen to and examine the world, we might remember how Simone Weil thought about attention, and how attention taken to its highest degree is the same as prayer. Margaret Gibson's poems are prayers to this world, not in all its beauty and lightness, but in all its joy amid the terrible suffering. We are so lucky she has come back home to be with us tonight. Please welcome Margaret Gibson.
Thank you all for coming out, and can you hear me?
Yes.
It's okay, good. I'm going to try to juggle too many books and papers up here and not knock the microphone into your lap. Lucky boy. All right. I want to thank the wonderful writers I had the privilege to work with this afternoon in the workshop for not being so scared of me or whatever that you didn't come to the reading. Here you are. Thank you. It was fun being with you this afternoon. And I want to thank all of you for being here and making this reading an ongoing event to support the soup kitchen in Willimantic. I loved what you had to say about it mattering about how the food is served and that it's served with love. That's the secret to everything. I want to begin with a new poem called Always an Immigrant. Can you hear me? Always an Immigrant. I'm not sure where the poem started. I mean, I can look around. We've got DACA going on right now and all sorts of problems with immigration and solving that great human travesty of an issue. But I think it really got started with a challenge from a Zen monk who wanted to know if it was possible to write a socially or politically minded poem without shaking your finger, without remembering compassion, without speaking from a position where there was integrity and rage, but also compassion and caring, widening that picture. So this is my attempt to do that. It's a poem called Always an Immigrant. Always an immigrant, the heart crosses borders and boundaries. It trespasses, it will not be held back. Windswept, sea swept, star swept, it is poor, porous, permeable. It is outcry and prayer and a murmur that ends with a question mark. Tell me, is it inside you, the immigrant heart, or are you inside it? I only know it contains multitudes. This heart whose color is not red or black or brown or yellow or white. The immigrant heart is transparent. There is a light inside it. It fuels galaxies, nurses a child, holds your beloved as he sinks over his last threshold, a thread of gold light just visible along the border of his body. Just look, the immigrant heart races naked along the tide line, kisses both bandage and wound, holds a cup to the mouth that thirsts, and the cup runneth over. It leaps with the suicide into the waterfall river, carries school books and ladders and songs. It translates the law and transforms it. This heart in the heart of the world brings the children out of cages, crates, and sealed truck beds. What is it, you ask? What is this immigrant heart, if not sweat, if not nectar, if not salt, if not aloe, if not what the sages have promised? The sages in their desert hovels and prison cells, the sages on street corners and in the subway turnstiles, they know how the immigrant heart gives from its own boundless mercy and light, crossing into beatitude and bliss, into pain and rejection. This heart, a new heart, always arriving. Your body, my body, one body, in the makeshift shelters we call our lives. I want to remind you, if you don't know already, that there are today 70 million people who are migrants displaced from home. And the projection is that by the year 2050, there will be 140 million climate refugees. I'm speaking tonight out of my reading poems tonight, out of my concern about climate crisis, climate change, environmental grief. And so most of the poems I have selected tonight, all of them really, have to do with my concern about what we have done and continue to do to the earth. Gary Snyder said that we really shouldn't try to scare people, and we just need to make them love the earth. But, you know, I've been writing, there's been nature imagery and nature subjects in my poems now for I don't know how long, years and years and years, really most of my life. And I think it's time to scare people a little bit. So I'm going to read you a poem which the editor of the Yale Review, who took it first, said, thanked me for being tactful. So maybe I wasn't quite angry enough in this one, I don't know. So you'll have to float a little bit. It's called Global Warming. And it reminds you that there's a distinction between weather and climate change, right? You know, people say, oh, it can't be global warming. It's such a cold spring. But the weather's not. Global warming. Even so, it's a cold spring. I unroll the map of the watershed and my fingers trace the blue threads of rivers as I touch the veins on a lover's throat. I chant Kalmia latifolia, Pinus sylvestris, Geum odoratissimum, as if I might travel once again more the fresh, once more the fresh land of the Choctaw and the Creek, as if the hooves of my horse, like Bartram's, might splash red with the juice of trampled berries. We fill the gas tank, chart the wobble of the earth, its tilt, the shape of its orbit. The words we taste, Milankovitch, Albedo, melt on my tongue like the Greenland ice sheet. Hear the beat of the drum? That's my heart. Come now, let us reason together. Because the honey creeper, because a bag of bones on a museum shelf in Mauritius, because clouds thicken like swamp gas in the marshland, because the fetus will not ripen, because the relic trillium and the tanager and the wren, because the solar flare of black flies on your skin, because malaria, because dengue fever, because of the dieback and the auction block, because the kestrel, because peach orchard is a memory of mildew, ash blue, because the fetus will not ripen, because earth everywhere is archipelago, because we taste the words, because we taste the words and they stick in our throats. Some of the words, I have to warn you, I'm in love with fancy words, and some of them in the poem, like Milankovitch, I can't even tell you now what it is, just like the sound of it. But albedo is that wonderful effect that of the sun reflecting off of ice, and so, you know, beginning cooling the earth off. And so once Greenland and other areas are melting, it gets warmer. I have this awful feeling that a lot of people will say about global warming, not you, not all of you in this room, no, no, but many would say, I didn't see it coming. And in fact, it's hard to see even when it's here. And so, although it's getting easier to spot it, isn't it, unfortunately. But we have been seeing it for a long time, and so I started thinking about Cassandra, the daughter of Priam and Troy, and how she knew the city would fall, and she knew the Greeks were coming, and told everyone, and no one listened. So this poem is called Cassandra and the Peach. And then some of the detail in the poem takes off from historical records of the Silk Road, the trade that connected the Far East with Europe and Middle Asia Minor. Cassandra and the Peach. From far-off hanging gardens overland, like a late arising moon above the Hindu Kush, hauled west by wagon and camel train, past its prime, mortal with a blush of bruise, more perishable than Bactrian gold or Sogdian cinnabar, and to her more precious, carried in a flat-bottomed basket covered in straw and starlight, as soon her people will be, soon everyone she loves. Now in her hands, this peach, her first and her last. She spits on it gently, brushing off dust and starlight. It is her life, it is her city, as good as raised. No one listens to her. No one sees the wine dark stains in the sand. Look here, for the last time, look. Over the sea, ships and their long oars, horses and chariots disembarking, a cloud of dust rolling toward the city. Listen, even now one can hear the bards, generations of them singing their heavily metered incremental story, an epic they memorize, singing into the future, our time of blue and gold Aegean catastrophe. Catastrophe, the very word has song tucked into it. Weary of prophecy, she eyes closed. Slowly she rolls the peach along her cheek, along the curve of her jawbone, pauses, bites in. Not even her father believes her. No one sees the dark blur on the horizon line as anything other than a change in weather. How near it is, ruin. As near as this peach whose juice runs down her neck, salt, sea lash, and blood. I just led a workshop or facilitated a workshop where people looked at specific objects. So there's the peach. I'm going to change my mind and read a poem called Glass Globe, which is the title poem of my new manuscript, my new book, coming in 2021. And the poem, I've written about the glass globe before. I wrote a prose essay about it that focused on it. The glass globe, the object that this poem begins to show you, is a globe about this big, hand-blown glass, and it sat at the top, when I was a little girl, it sat at the top of my aunt's, on a table at the top of her staircase. She had a candle in it at Christmas, and it sort of floated, and it was the most magical thing I can remember, and it's what she gave me, or left me, after she died. And I wrote about it once and described it. And as you will hear in the poem, the glass globe stays as the focus of the poem, but as I was hoping to introduce my workshoppers this afternoon to the idea that you can start with your eye on one thing, throw it into your awareness, and have the ripple effect go out to the edges of the cosmos, almost, if you follow it far enough. So let's follow and see what happens to the glass globe. Wanting to begin again, a form of denial. I copy from a book, rearranging the words, adding line breaks with a shaking hand. This morning, from where I sit, the rug is dark blue and burgundy, brighter where a length of full sun from an east window falls. On the shelf of the bay window, a large glass globe, hand-blown, the color of air over the shallows of the Sound summer mornings, shimmers. It all but floats. This morning, glad of it, I'm not going anywhere, content as the globe fills with quiet simplicity of light. This glass globe is a made thing, a synthesis of sand and fire, air and muscle and lung and tool, a flaring of energies joined and transformed, and because of the quality of attention that went into it, beautiful. It rests in a precarious place. I have to move it aside as I open the windows. I shift it when I dust, and if I'm not careful, too near and my mood hard and angular, I may knock against it. It's the end of the passage. And this is history. This is prose. My prose. Words in a book now out of print. Words underlined by my husband, whose hand now is ash in a wood-fired ceramic jar. Except for me, everyone who came to our wedding is dead. I'm in another house now. The glass globe rests in a different light. Each morning I walk out of this house to stand alone in the quiet of these woods, whose leaf-rumpled earth, so long ago now, was cleared and planted, grazed, hayed, harvested, abandoned. Before that, scraped clean by the sharpened edge of the glacier. Before that was marsh and sediment. Before that, shoal and sea depth. Before that, stone. When I take off my shoes, my bare feet touch granite that was here before leafy decay and woods earth formed. Now I stand on it, shaken, trying to recover what's left of my composure. I've done it. The vault is mine. Nor does it matter that a Chinese sage holding up a ceramic bowl smaller than the globe in my window, but beautiful, therefore the same. Everything that partakes of beauty is the same. This gentlest of sages smiled and said, "The bowl is already broken." And he meant live with it that way. Love it. Love it crazed and cracked. Love it broken, because everything, everything already is broken. And was it moments ago, dusting, I lifted the glass globe, and when I set it down, it cracked. Even gently, despite generations of care and abuse, it cracked, two fault lines rising now from the base nearly to the lip. And here's the crazy miracle. It holds. It still holds. But do the math, estimate probability, run the numbers, run out of the house appalled, then stand here, bare feet on raw granite, from which a whispered certainty, we're done for, rises razor thin through flesh and bone, then lodges, a splinter of glass in my throat. Funny poem coming. You have to hang on or wait for it. I'm going to read you the title poem of a book that came out in 2008 called One Body. My mother, I grew up in Virginia, and my mother grew up in a little county in Virginia called Dinwiddie. And she was the daughter of farmers. And watched her brothers. It was a large farm family when she grew up through the Depression before that. But she would watch her brothers clear the wheat fields on a tractor, and starting at the edge of the field, move closer in and in to the center. And they'd leave a stand of wheat in the center, and then brother on the tractor would be joined by a couple of others, and they would take their rifles and go into the stand of wheat, where you'll hear what happens. Part of my, something I said today in the workshop, and it's a abiding belief of mine, that we can't have compassion for anyone or anything else unless we put ourselves in position with it, see through its eyes, situate ourselves with that person or whomever, whatever. And we don't do that enough, I don't think, with other beings that are here with us on Earth. So this poem attempts to do that. It's called One Body. I am born in a field of cornflowers and ripe wheat. Wind in the black gum trees late afternoon before the storm, and the men are cutting the field, working the mower in circles, coming in and in toward the center of the field where I crouch down with the rabbits, with the quail driven into this space by the clackety mower, because I want to see how the body goes still, how the mind, how the lens of an eye magnifies to an emptiness so deep, so flared wide, there is everywhere field and the source of field, and only a quiver of the nose or the flick of a topknot feather, a ripple so faint I may have imagined it, says yes, says no to the nearing rustle in the last stand of wheat. And now it's quiet, too quiet. A soft trample, a click, the cocking sound, a swish as the men steal in to take what they want. They are clever, they are hungry, and because this one body is my birthplace, my birthright, my only home place, my nest and burrow and bower, I understand. My mother is wheat, my father is wind, and I rise in a tall gust of rage and compassion. I rise up from the mown and edible debris of the world, wrapped in a bright net of pollen and stars, my thighs twin towers of lightning, and my voice. I am a storm of voices, snipe and wolf, snow goose, dolphin, quail, and lark. Stop this. Stop it now, I say to the men who stalk closer, keen on the kill, late light on the steel of their rifles. And they are my brothers. They are my brothers, and I love them too. Look into my eyes, I tell them. See for yourself the one shining field. Look into my eyes before you shoot. Eyes are really not twin towers of lightning, but I get that way. I feel that powerful when my passion is up. Alex, are you here? Okay, Alex today in the workshop picked a snake skin. One of the reasons I love critters so much is that I live in an old house, probably built somewhere in the early 1700s, in the middle of the woods. So the house is really not my house. It's really, I share it with critters, principally with black snakes. Anybody here afraid of snakes? Don't come see me. And the poem will narrate for you an incident when I think you'll follow very easily, when I went into the dining room having heard something fall from the mantle and wanted to see what it was. Toward the end of the poem, in the second part, the speaker of the poem imagines the coil of song coming out of the snake's body. So it's an attempt to translate or even give a voice to the snake that you'll hear there at the end of the poem. I'm not sure that part succeeds, but I like the rest of it. Okay, black snake. When in the darkened room I hear a clatter from the mantle of the central chimney with its many chinks and turn to see why a plate has leapt to the floor on its own, I freeze as a sleek, thick ribbon of snake slides like rain over the dark, rough stones of the chimney and into an opening I swear is no wider than the eye of my wedding ring. And I understand Persephone at a standstill just before she swallows the single seed on her complicit tongue, and Orpheus as he turns and stares into the retreating pour of black mist. I have seen a black snake loop from an oak limb as cursive in the air as a Chinese acrobat. I've watched one meditate in the shade of a blue mist bush, the thick lump in its long throat slowly shrinking. And in the corner of the summer attic, I've held in my hands a snake skin, torn at both ends, rumbled at the head where it split, and the snake tugged free. What is a snake that it casts off such transparent trappings? What is this skin in which I find a nature that's empty, not unlike my own? Were I a loose swirl, a blackwater ripple, one continuous long throat, what would be the song I'd inscribe on stone, on ground, on grass? No beginning to it, no end. Snake comes through winter, its tail in its mouth, and a coil of song issues from the deepest trance of its body. I am not what I was in the cold, in the dark, neither the joy before grief nor the joy after, only the inflected spark at the base of the spine, half-conscious spark, indifferent spasm, the spill of night into flesh gone nameless, sliding and flowing into nothing as real as this pounding of the heart. Coyotes.
Mm-hmm.
Can anybody do a coyote? Come on, come on, come on.
Mm-hmm.
Do it. Somebody. No? Nobody's going to imitate a coyote, you think? All right. Well, usually they travel in packs and they sound something like this. So that's what I listen to out the kitchen door where I live. You can't imagine how much fun it is to do that. Next time somebody asks you to do a coyote, would you please do it?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. It's a poem called Coyote. The owl belongs to Athena, the coyote to no one. Not to the winter belly of the dark in which I hear the one and many voices of coyote lift and circle. Not even to the moon. When I want to join in, I open the kitchen door and yip a little. How the woods fall silent then. Not until the door clicks shut and I stand there as if in a trance, listening, do they begin again. Are they afraid of me? Or does my interruption of their litanies constitute plain rudeness? Who does she think she is? But it's the intimate swirl, those high-pitched, rapturous interrogatives, cries that lift out of a dark too deep for words. It's the tongue that flicks the hollow of my throat just here along the branching collarbone. That's the song that belongs to no one. A song that says, you know who you are. This is your song, too. The introduction talked about knitting together the inner and the outer and how that had been a basic move in my work for years, and it's true. And just to prove that I'm still doing it, I'm going to read this poem called Riverkeeper. I am listening to a river in this poem outside, but also listening to the river inside. poem is called, do you know what a river keeper is? A river keeper, there is one for the Hudson River. Mm-hmm. For some mighty rivers, there is a job assigned so that someone is actually looking after the river and its health and its ecology and so forth. The poem is called River Keeper. Wanting to be that place where inner and outer meet. This morning, I'm listening to the river inside, also to the river out the window, river of sun and branch shadow, muskrat and mallard, heron and the rattled cry of the kingfisher. Out there is a tree whose roots the river has washed so often, the tree stretches beyond itself, its spirit like mine, leaning out over the water, held only by the poised astonishment of being here. This morning, listening to the river inside, I'm sinking into a stillness where what can't be said stirs beneath currents of image and memory, below stratos of muon and quarks, now rushes, now hushes and pools, now casts a net of bright light so loosely woven, there's a constellation afloat on the surface of the river, so still I can almost hear it weave in and out, interstellar, intercellular. And isn't it truly one world? No in or out, no here or there. Seamless, as a lily about to open from just here into everywhere, is. Just is. Restful lily. Plucky lily. To bloom must feel like a river's brightening at daybreak, or a slow kiss, a throb in the elapse of time, a shudder of heron shadow flying over shallows that are merely the apparent skim of a depth whose bottomless surface seeps everywhere. An anchored flow that upholds city and cathedral, bridge and gate, Orion, odd toad in the Amazon, blue dragonfly, what it is to love. Spoil a river, you spoil all this. When do you want me to stop?
Another 5 minutes. Another 5 minutes.
Okay, I'm not going to read. You don't get the funny poem because I've only got 5 minutes.
Oh.
I'll tell you the poem, however, afterwards if you'd like. When my late husband died, I was with him and also his daughter and son. And after he died, we washed his body. And it was one of the most direct and simple and beautiful acts I've ever been part of. And I remember I've written a poem called Washing the Body, which I'll read you some other time. It's a short poem. But that's the starting place for this poem called Irrevocable. Because I began to muse, I hope not too soft-headedly, about ways to save the planet. And I'm not talking about far-fetched ideas of sending spaceships up with special thick dust and so forth. There are all kinds of technological notions about how we might be able to save what we're spoiling. But how about an old-fashioned, we do for the planet what we do for the one we love the most? What about figuring out a way to take those strategies and adapt them to the planet? So having begun this book, The Glass Globe, with a poem called Washing the Body, I am ending it with a poem called Irrevocable, where I wash the planet. So it's a a bit of a long poem, flowed a little bit. This is an elegy that I hope doesn't come true. Irrevocable. Someone no longer alive is hovering over a great expanse of smartweed, panic grass, and midden where a house used to be, where trees and gardens once flourished, where puddles and ponds held a sky of clouds and stars in place for a moment. And you lived there, my dear. I speak from the liminal space where your beloved's last barely audible breath slipped into your body, then out the window into the winter chill, whose horizon line it rolled up as if it were twine into a point, a still point, a full stop that opens the heart. From that point, I speak. As once you washed the body of your beloved, let us wash for the last time this one earth, this only and only once, for once and all, earth, as if it were a lover who has died and we, not knowing what to do at last, must wash the poles, north and south, where long ago the ice cracked open, sheared off, and melted. Last, the mountain peaks. Last, the crowns of oaks and maples on whose bare branches long strips of torn plastic flutter. Also, the steeples, the turrets, the domes. Last, the open fields and meadows, wash them clean. The vast desert and its last oasis. Riverbeds and shrunken rills, ravines and gullies, the rocky promontories from which we viewed the sea as it rose to cover the cities. Last, the cities. Submerged full fathom or in low tide, only the tips of the high wires rises wrinkling up and the towers. Last, the sidewalks, shop windows, market stalls. Last, pebble, shell and skull, last lark and satellite, wash them, and the field of broken mirrors. Last the house, last the bed, last the hills of midden and their treasures, a button, a seed, a feather, a zipper, a chip of china plate. Last the nose cone, the black box, last the trawler, the landing gear, the microchip, the missing part. Last, the prayer rugs, the pews, the cushions. Last, the seat of enlightenment beneath what remains of the small trees spreading canopy. Last, the factories, the foundries, the mills, the maze of subway tunnels, the turnstiles. Last, the eye of the needle through which we could not pass. Last, a gun, a mine, a missile. Last, a bridge. Last, middle C on the piano. Last, a cello, a violin cello. In particular, the sonata for violin cello number 2 in D, opus 64, by Heinrich von Herzogenberg. Precious because it was the last music he listened to. Precious because the last word, like the last word your beloved spoke, you didn't know it was last. Last, the pattern of fish displayed on ice and their many-eyed, one-eyed stare. Last, the last whale beached on the shore at Truro. Last, the glint of an eye in the periwinkle, the lovely sinuous ripple of a reclusive snake. Last, the chemicals, the vitamins, the pills, the chemicals. Last, a hearing aid, a pair of binoculars, a surgeon's knife, a sling, a robotic hand. Last, to list only a few from the multitude that perished, fox and laughing gull, swallowtail and hawk, panther, vole, giraffe, mosquito, trillium, hummingbird, hibiscus, owl. Last, the very last line in a poem by Rilke, the line you can't forget the ache of, the line you didn't enact, not one syllable of it. You must change your life. Space, of course, lasts. I walk upon it as one would walk on a tablecloth for a table no one will set. What's left of my eyesight is dimmed, what I hear is only wind, and that muted. And because I have nothing to write on, I build cairn after cairn, lifting stones, balancing them, touching what remains in place as if it were a new alphabet or a sentence in Braille. You are reading the last of the earth's last rivers and mountains. Do you know that? These stones, these silences, the last words held in mind for a moment, as if they were a net of fireflies shimmering in a summer field one can't tell apart from a night sky and stars. Wash them, each stone, each firefly, wash them clean. This one, a love cry, that one, lament. And the last one, the wing of a warning you might still be able to hear. Just as once, long ago, you caught the smoke of the oracle rising from a rift zone at the center of the earth. If these cairns, these stone syllables, survive, there may be no one left to read the poem they make. But if by chance there is, let the stones be read aloud so that a human voice might widen its reach, floating off among the stars like the ringing through of a great bronze bell, like the audible layers of birdsong gradually moving west as dawn brightens, or used to, and the great earth turns. I promise you the poem is funny.